All right. Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you as you are finding your way in and your seat. It's great to come together and fellowship. It's great to know that we are here. We are bound together by the Holy Spirit to come and just to worship together as one, as the body of Christ. And so it's a privilege. And so if this is your first time, welcome to Woodland United Fellowship. My name is Pastor Les, and we are all grateful that you are here to join us this morning. Just a couple things. Today at 4:30, you're all invited back to our potluck for our family meal and family meeting tonight. If you're not a member, come anyway. We will feed you. Don't bring any food. There'll be plenty of food here. And then if you just want to hang around and see what's going on in the life of the church, then stick around, and we would love to have you join us. Also, last Friday, we had several people from the church out in the community. We had six people down on Main Street for the movie night, just being there and visible and talking to the community. And we had about 20 of us down at Freeman School helping out Dr. Gonzalez and their staff just put on a huge, huge fall festival. And it was tiring, but it was fun. And we had opportunities to tell people who we are, where we're from. And it was a great, great evening as we were out just loving on the community. So keep them in prayer. Keep our community in prayer. They need Jesus Christ. And we are the vehicle that God is using to take that message out to this community. So keep that in mind. But let's go ahead and pray, and then we will get started this morning. Father, you are so good. And Lord, we thank you for the work that you began in us. And Lord, we know one day it will be completed as we will join you, perfected and glorified in heaven with you, Father. That is our reward, and that's what we strive for and persevere in, and just straining towards that ultimate end with you, Father. And Lord, the hope that it brings in our everyday life, we thank you for that. And Father, now we just want to come and worship you. Lord, we want to say thank you for the mercy that you have shown us, and say thank you for the grace that you have shown us, Father. To say thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who you gave to us as a sacrifice, as an atonement for our sins, that we may have life, Lord. And that is joyful. That is worthy of praise. And we want to do that this morning. So this is for you, Lord, an offering to you. And we thank you, Lord, that we can do this. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Stand with us today.
Lift up your voices and lift up your praise. Join with the heavens, declaring the wonders of His faithfulness forever.
tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumph of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth and the honors of
come on. take my life and let it be consecrated more to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and
take our will, Father, that you would make it your own. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, worship team. Children ages 3 to 5 are welcome to go to Children's Church. And the rest of you can open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians. It's like all year we've been saying that. All year. Come back next year when we'll be in, not really. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is where we'll be this morning. Looking at, we'll spend a couple weeks in chapter 14. This week, speaking about tongues, and the next week we'll talk about prophecy. right? Two just fascinating subjects. And if you're new here, we welcome you to Woodland United Fellowship. As you may note in your bulletin, my name is Pastor Dooba, and honored to be able to spend time in God's Word with you today. We have been walking through this book and seeing how really church is supposed to function biblically. The church in Corinth had all sorts of issues going on, things that they were doing because of culture, because of tradition, because of the way they interpreted things, because of people's just opinions running the church as opposed to God's word. And so Paul has been walking through in this book just the importance of, in this last couple chapters, orderly worship and what it looks like to trust in God's Spirit to guide and direct. Chapter 12, he talked about spiritual gifts. He took a pause in chapter 13 to talk about love. And then we spent the last couple weeks talking about chapter 13. And then this week and next week, we'll look at chapter 14. And if you haven't been with us and watched through some of the sermons already, you can go online, you can watch through them. If we go through some of this stuff and you're like, that seems like a really interesting subject or passage, you can always go back and watch those things. In the description, maybe you know this, maybe you don't, in the descriptions on the videos on YouTube that we have for recording this service, there are notes, a link to be able to look at some of the notes from whoever's preaching that day. So if you'd like to go back and look at some more details on that, feel free to do that. There is going to be a lot of stuff that we're covering today, and so I do encourage you, if you want to look at some stuff in detail, you could link through in a couple days. I'll have the notes posted there, and you could look through some of my notes in more detail on this subject. As Pastor Les mentioned, meeting today. Next weekend, there's a ladies' retreat, if I remember correctly, and so a bunch of ladies will not be here, from my understanding, but I think there's a meeting after church today for many of those who are going. So things to have in your mind. Let's read through the part of the passage of chapter 14 that we'll be looking at today, and then we'll pray, and then we'll really dive into this really interesting subject. So starting in verse 1 of chapter 14, we'll read through verse 28, and then we'll pause and look at a couple other verses. So starting in chapter 14, verse 1, it starts off saying this. You can look in your Bibles with me. Pursue love. And he just talked in chapter 13 all about love. So the value, the importance that we need to lean into first and foremost, pursue. That word pursue is to like chase after. It's like a military term of chasing something down. Pursue love and earnestly desire spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. And that's what we'll talk about next week in a little bit more detail. For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men but to God, for no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. Now I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in a tongue, unless someone interprets, so that the church may be built up. Verse 6, now, brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you unless I bring to you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? Verse 7, if even lifeless instruments such as the flute or the harp do not give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is played? And if the bugle gives an indistinct sound, who will get ready for battle? So with yourselves, if with your tongue you utter speech that is not intelligible, how will anyone know what is said? For you will be speaking into the air. There are doubtless many languages in the world, and none is without meaning. But if I do not know the meaning of the language, I will be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker to a foreigner to me. So with yourselves, since you are eager for manifestations of the Spirit, which we talked about before, they all wanted that. They wanted to see how is the Spirit manifesting itself in various gifts. They were clinging to various gifts. So with yourselves, since you are eager for manifestations of the Spirit, strive to excel in what? Building up the church. Verse 13, therefore, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing also with my mind. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you're saying? for you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. Verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in the church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. He concludes in the next few verses, Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. In the law is written, by people of strange tongues and by lips of foreigners will I speak to this people. And even then, they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Thus, tongues are not a sign for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign for unbelievers, but for believers. Not for unbelievers, but for believers. If, therefore, the whole church comes together and all speak in tongues, and an outsider or unbeliever enters, will they not say you are out of your minds? But if all prophesy, and an unbeliever or outsider enters, he is convicted by all. He is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed. And so, falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. What then, brothers? When you come together, each one has a hymn or a lesson or a revelation or a tongue or interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. If anyone speaks in a tongue, let there only be two or three at most. And in turn, let someone interpret. But if there be no one to interpret, let them keep silent and speak to himself and to God. We'll skip to verse 39. So, brothers, at the end of the chapter, my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. Wow. Well, Lord, we come before you this morning. We look at this text here in front of us, this passage, your word that your spirit inspired through the Apostle Paul that we are able to read many, many years later that still give us instruction and direction today. I just want to see your spirit guide our conversation today, our time here today, enlighten our hearts and minds. The things that I say would be from you, grounded here in your word, both in this passage and as your word as a whole, Lord, that we would today be open to what you want to say. Put aside for a moment tradition, put aside for a moment our interpretation or experiences, and look at your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Wow, a lot of stuff going on here, right? The gifts is something that the church in Corinth wanted to pursue in many ways. Many of us, many of you here in this room, watching various places, whatever that may be, have had experiences perhaps with this topic of tongues, right? How many of you have had some experience with that? Some experience, whether that be in a church setting that you've heard other people speak in another language, maybe a language that you understood or didn't understand, maybe people talking about that. Maybe you've just heard a lot about it, you've watched videos about it, you've read stuff about it, but you're not really familiar what the word actually has to say. Chapter 14 is the most succinct place that you'll find in Scripture that speaks to this, that gives instruction about this than anywhere else in Scripture. There's other places in Scripture that we see this spoken about, but this gives all-inclusively more instruction and more information than we'll find than any other place. And so as we walk through just talking about tongues today, just want to encourage you to look through Scripture, see what the Bible has to say, because experience can be varied with all of your different places that you go, that you hear from, but what does the Word of God have to say? And so as we walk through this, just that's what I'm going to lean on in this time. Notice it does start, and we saw in the chapter before, that the most important thing, and we even see in this chapter, is the building up of God's people. And we're going to see that stream go through this entire chapter. It's vital that God's people are built up in the practice of the gifts of the Spirit, or in the work of the Holy Spirit. So we see even the beginning, verse 1, pursue love, that word chase down, and especially desire, it goes on, prophecy. And we'll talk about that a little bit later, but Paul's emphasis is, I want to see the church built up. I wrote this down in your bulletin, you can see that there. This subject has brought more division, difficulty, and dissension in the life of the church than probably many or any of the other gifts. And today we'll see what Scripture has to say about that and how it's practiced. There's been a lot of experiences and stories about this that you've heard, maybe through other people, your experiences, whatever, but what does Scripture have to say? A little bit of context, culture, things to remember as we walk into this, is they, the people that this is being written to, did not have the whole Bible in their hands. Many of them would not have had even maybe the Old Testament that they're able to easily access, which was not in mass production, or if they were able to get their hands on it, it would have been expensive. Unlike many of us have many Bibles, or you can just open your phone and download a Bible. That was not an option that they had there. So because of that, many of them would have relied on spiritual gifts like knowledge or prophecy to guide them in understanding God's word or God's heart. And this is one reason these gifts would have greatly decreased at the conclusion of the canon and the distribution of God's word as that continued. The gifts of needing to go, what is God trying to say? Well, now it's written down in front of you. So that's why many have seen, and even as we look at history, at the close of the canon, we see the gifts being practiced in the life of the church greatly decreased. So though God's word is not worldwide in every language, these gifts, even prophecy or knowledge, might still be practiced in places where the word of God is not prevalent or not printed in their language. That's a conversation for another day. A couple weeks ago, we talked about cessationism. That is, the gifts have ceased, and some people kind of in that camp. And then continuationism, that is, the gifts are continuing for today, mainly the gifts of healing, gifts of tongues, prophecy is often talked about in this continuationism. I don't know where you are in that, and so as we look at tongues today, what we're going to do, and you see this in your outline, I just left an open portion there for you, talking about the understanding tongues, just to be able to write down some things to see what this passage and other scriptures have to say about this gift. So I encourage you to write things down, and like I said, you can go back and read through some notes later if you'd like. So, deeply biblical, let's dive right into this. So, understanding tongues. The first thing that you could write down, I have 5 points. They're not on the screen, but you could write them down on your outline. 5 points that you could write down in the understanding tongues portion. The first thing is this. The tongues is a mysterious language to those who don't know it. And that seems pretty straightforward at first, but we'll look at some scriptures here, and this is on... I don't think this is on the screen, actually. Verse 2, verse 11, and verse 16 say this: "For the one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God, for no one understands him. But he utters mysteries in the spirit. But if they do not know the meaning of the language, I will be a foreigner to them." Again, we see this idea of this mysterious language. Verse 16 says, "How will they know what you are saying if you're speaking in a tongue?" This is a foreign or a mysterious language to those who are both speaking it, unless they have the ability to interpret, and to those who are listening. The other thing that we see here is this. The point two that you could write down in understanding tongues is this point here that I'm about to say is not believed or not agreed on by many folks. That I see from Scripture, this is an actual language. An actual language, and you can jot that down. We see that in verse 10. "There are doubtless," Paul says, "many different languages in the world, and none without meaning." Also, you look back at Acts chapter 2. You could jot this down. You don't have to flip there, but you can if you wish. Acts chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, we look at Pentecost. This is what it says at Pentecost. "And at this sound," that is, remember the rushing wind, remember that happens, tongues of fire appear. "At this sound, a multitude of people came together, and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them," that is, people came at Pentecost. They gathered together, people from all over the known world at the time, speaking different languages, they're coming from different cultures. They were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. "And they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these people who are speaking Galileans?" In other words, how are they able to speak all of these different languages? People coming from, let's say, northern Africa show up in Egypt and various places, and they're like, "Wait, I can understand. Can you understand? Like, we can all understand him. Look at, this is amazing." There's also a list given in verses 9 through 11, the first part of verse 11 in Acts 2, of various nationalities. Really, Acts chapter 2 lists off various nationalities that are present there at Pentecost, and all of these people able to hear these apostles speaking in their language. Also, this is not, as some might say, an ecstatic utterance. There are some phrases Paul uses in 1 Corinthians saying that no one understands them. And so they say, "Oh, it's just some random things that they're saying." Why might no one understand them? Maybe because they're all from one place. if they're speaking in a language and somebody there is speaking in, I don't know, a language from Papua New Guinea, and they're in Corinth and no one knows that language, it would sound like gibberish. But it doesn't say that it's just some random things that they're saying. They're only speaking one language in Corinth. So that's the second thing that you could jot down. It's an actual language. We see that from Scripture. We don't see other places in Scripture that say it's just something else other than that. The third thing, this is really interesting. Maybe some of you have thought about this, considered this, or maybe know this already. This seems to be, from Scripture we read here, a spiritual connection, not mental. And not to say that it's crazy people, but it seems to be that there's a spiritual connection in the midst of or in the practicing of this gift of tongues. Verse 14 and 19 give us a little bit of clarity on this. Look what it says in verse 14. Again, your Bible should be open. You should be looking through this. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is, look what it says in verse 14, unfruitful. Verse 19, nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak five words with my mind in order to instruct other people than 10,000 words in a tongue. Again, we have that idea of this mental connection here that happens when you're speaking in the language, your native language, as opposed to a tongue that's different. As we see, as we've seen, Scripture teaches that a tongue is an actual language, and thus God wants to give someone the ability to speak in a different language to help bridge a language barrier, God can do that. But that's different than the gift of tongues. God can simply say, like, hey, you're a missionary in Africa, you don't speak that language, and I find it that would be beneficial for you to be able to speak to that person, share the gospel in that language. Sure, God can do that. But we don't see that being the gift of tongues. Fourthly, you could jot this down, Paul did not speak negatively about tongues. Paul did not speak negatively about it. Verse 39 says, and this should not be forbidden. We read that earlier. But he gave clear direction for it to be done privately, unless it be interpreted. We never see Paul pray in tongues, but in verse 18, he says he prays in tongues more than everybody else. Verse 39 says, so my brothers earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. Verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. But again, we don't see that, which I think is an important thing to draw out, because it must not be something that Paul is saying this is necessary for your faith or for your salvation. We'll get to that in just a minute. To be the fifth thing you can write down is this. It is to be, that is the practice, the gift of tongues, is to be interpreted and done in order. We see this in verse 5 through 13, verse 27, and verse 40. The ability to interpret, as you see, by the way, if you look back in chapter 12, the ability to interpret tongues is also a gift. So somebody who has the gift of being able to speak in a tongue, they might have the gift of being able to interpret, but they might not. So when that's spoken, it should be done in, it should be interpreted as well. Verses 5 through 13 says, hey, if you're going around speaking in a tongue, remember, like, if I can speak in tongues, like if I can prophesy or whatever, but I have not love, what does it say in chapter 13? I'm like a clanging gong, I'm a clanging cymbal, it's pointless. There's no reason for that to happen. Same thing is true. If somebody stands up in church and they just start, like, talking in another language, is that edifying the church? No. It's distracting. People are confused. Verse 27, if I speak in a tongue, let there be only two or three at most. And each in turn, let someone interpret. Scripture's clear about that as well. Verse 40, all things should be done decently and in order. So those five things, I think, just important to, like, get our heads around before those three points that you'll see here that we'll fill in a minute. This is also a gift of God. It's not learned. We see that being practiced at times. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that you have to, like, someone's going to come along and there's going to be a class about this. And it does not mean because you don't speak in tongues that you're a subpar Christian. It doesn't mean, like, why speak in tongues? You don't? Well, clearly, Jesus isn't with you as much. Or you don't have as much of the Spirit as I do, or whatever that may be. We see from Scripture this is a gift. And I mentioned this earlier, and I think this is still super important. Your experience around tongues does not mean that that is fact. If it does not align with Scripture. This is a secondary issue regarding salvation, and one where there is allowed to be various interpretations of places where Scripture is not clear. So why tongues? Why is this even a thing? The purpose of tongues, that's what three points there that we'll talk about here. First thing that you can write down is this, the purpose of tongues, to speak to God, and that's on the screen as well. Verse 14 and verse 28 say this as well. And this is something that is an interesting, important piece to draw out. This is something that is a gift to be able to speak, a gift between one person and God, that is the gift of tongues. So from man to God, that is. The gift of prophecy, as we'll see tomorrow, is from God to man. So two different things there. One from man to God, the other from God to man. There are times you might be in a church service and hear someone speak in a tongue, and then in an effort for them to be biblical in that sense, someone might stand up and say, "Thus saith the Lord," and try to interpret that. Have any of you been in that situation before? Maybe not. So that happens at times where someone will say, "This is what they said. I'm here to interpret what was just said," and they then give a message or a word to the congregation. This is interesting because when we look through Scripture, what we don't see is that actually being someone speaking in a tongue to people, but rather it's something that is directed towards God. So that interpretation might be prophecy, or it might just be someone making something up, but if it's directed towards people, we don't actually see that being a biblical thing. What we do see, they might be able to interpret, like, let's say if they have the gift of interpretation, to interpret what did that person say to God. But it's not seen in Scripture as something directed towards people, but rather directed towards God. Some examples of that. In Acts chapter 2, verse 4, 6, and then chapter 10 of Acts, we see that not actually speaking to men, but praising God. Verse 4 says in Acts chapter 2, "And they were filled," they being the apostles, "were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." It doesn't say that it was to other people, but rather they were just speaking. Verse 6 of Acts 2 says, "At this sound, the multitude came together," as we read earlier. "They were bewildered because they heard them speak in their own language." And then what do we see in verse 46 of chapter 10? "And as they were hearing them speak in their own language and tongue and extolling God," they were praising God, "and other people heard that." Also, we see it's something that comes from the deepest part of someone's being that words cannot express. It's an overflow of praise meant to be between you and God, this relationship right here, not for other people's edification. In the early church, this was a sign, I think, in my opinion, this was a sign of their spirit being renewed, the Holy Spirit now connecting with God or speaking, praising God for that transformation that just happened in their life. And then it was an outward thing that people were able to see. Thus, in the early church, what we saw was, they're saved, then they're speaking in a tongue. It's like, oh, wait, something changed inside of them, and now they're praising God for that there. This was unique, and in no place in Scripture do we see that it's a requirement for salvation. So the purpose of tongue. One, speak with God. Paul makes that clear as well. The second thing is this, for self-edification. For self-edification. Verse 4, 6, 16. "Anyone who speaks in a tongue, for the one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but for the one who prophesies, he builds up the church." Verse 6 says, "Now brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you?" In other words, like, what benefit is it to you if I come to you and I'm talking in some other language? If that's ever happened to you, you've gone to another country and someone speaks to you in another language, or in America, you stare at them and you're like, I don't know what you're saying. I mean, I'm sure it's nice or lovely, but I have no idea what's going on here. Verse 16, he talks about this giving thanks with his spirit. Something took place or takes place, depending on where you are and if you believe this is still continuing today or not, in the act of speaking in a tongue to God that was beyond what takes place in our natural or native tongue. There seems to be some deeper connection that we see in Scripture around this that edifies the believer who's praying here. A few passages, Jude verse 20 says this, "But ye, beloved, beloved, building yourself up," or yourselves up, "on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit." So even in Scripture, we see this phrase, praying in the Spirit. And some people would say that that's praying in tongues, or it's praying directly between you and God. It's not about other things. It's praising him, and that edifies yourself. But keep in mind, that's not the only way someone can be edified, right? Praise God for that. Because we also have the Word of God that we're able to edify and build each other up and build ourselves up. We're able to interact with other people and be built up. We're able to pray even in our native language, whatever that may be, and be edified in that. But this gift of being able to pray in tongues or speak in tongues seems to be for the person's self-edification. And Paul doesn't seem to downplay that. He says, okay, that's great, and I can do that, and I do that, but that's not beneficial to the life of the church. Again, that then makes us ask the question, why would it need to be practiced publicly in the church? I ask myself that question. I maybe take a step to the side. What benefit is that to everybody else? Prayer in your own language is good and edifying, and do that. The third thing is this. Don't close your Bibles after this, because there's a lot of stuff here. The third thing is this, to prove God's power. And this is just, there's some interesting stuff here. We see this in verse 22. I put this on the screen because it's just an interesting verse as we read through this. Verse 22, thus tongues are a sign not for believers but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign not for unbelievers but for believers. And read that and you're like, what are you saying? Right before that, he says, "It is written, or as is written in the law, is also there in that in this portion of text." What are we talking about here? He says, "It's written in the law." What does this verse mean? The purpose of tongues, that is, speaking of an unknown language, being spoken to a group of people in the past, and catch this, is to pronounce impending judgment. And this is seen, you can see this in Deuteronomy 28, Isaiah 28, Jeremiah chapter 5. In Isaiah 28, I'll just read a verse here. It says, "For by people of strange lips and with a foreign tongue, the Lord will speak to his people." Here's what happens in the Old Testament, is when God's people, who he's been trying to get a hold of, he's like, hey, wake up, you're doing the wrong thing, and he's speaking through a prophet, trying to wake up the people of Israel, trying to get their attention, and they continue to ignore him over and over and over again. God's people, God's prophets, we see this in Deuteronomy, Isaiah, and in Jeremiah, where he's like, all right, you're not listening to me. Judgment's coming, and people are going to come and speak in a different language, which then implies that people of another nation are going to come in and do something with you. And in this case, as Scripture shows, that it's because of judgment. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, he says, "The Lord will bring nation against you from far away, from the ends of the earth, sweeping down like an eagle, like a nation whose language you do not understand." And then he goes on to show this is the kind of judgment that's going to happen to you because you've been ignoring God's word. So the first piece here to prove under this, you could write down there, to prove God's, or to bring about or to communicate God's judgment to the lost, or power to the lost. Just interestingly, just as in the Old Testament, there were people speaking in different languages before judgment occurred. Some Jews might even have been thinking the same thing at Pentecost. Because remember, they would have known the Old Testament well, and then these people show up, start speaking in a different language. They might be thinking, uh-oh, is judgment going to come? Because we've seen this in Jeremiah, we saw this in Deuteronomy, and we saw this in Isaiah, when God says, hey, people are going to show up and speak in a different language. Is there judgment that's possibly coming? Had those people, the Jews at Pentecost, had they rejected God's word? Yeah. Jesus had just come and they put him on a cross. They had rejected him, and now we see some people speaking in tongues. I think perhaps some of them might have gone, uh-oh, what might be about to happen? And there was actually judgment that happened. God did say, okay, Jews, you ignore Jesus, and now because of that, we're going to graft in the Gentiles. There's judgment that's going to happen because of your rejection of the presence of God, quite literally Jesus showing up here. So some of that might have been spinning through some of their heads as well at Pentecost. Wayne Grudem says this about verse 22, 23. Uninterpreted tongues are a sign to unbelievers of God's displeasure or impending judgment. And Paul, not wanting the Corinthians to give unbelievers the sign, discourages this childish, he uses the word childish, if you notice in verse 20, this childish use of uninterpreted tongues in the Corinthian church meeting. Prophecy, however, was a clear sign of God's presence with presence and with God's people, the believers. And so Paul naturally encourages its use when unbelievers are present in order that they may see this sign and thereby come to Christian faith. Thus, if outsiders or unbelievers come in and you speak in a language they can't understand, they'll clearly probably just walk away. Why am I here? I'm not being edified. There's no reason for me to be in this gathering of people. Thus, Paul's clear. Don't permit uninterpreted tongues in the church. In so doing that, you're just going to drive away people. Why would they want to stick around? Secondly, another piece of proving God's power. This can show, as God desires, God can communicate in other people's language to bring people together. Acts 2, we see at Pentecost, we see that was on some level, we might even say that for an evangelistic purpose, I should say. People heard, and they're like, oh, what's going on? This is new. How are they able to do this? I'm going to stick around and listen on. And then as you note, Peter afterwards stands up, and he gives an incredible message after that. People would have been coming in from all over the place right before that message, and Peter probably stood up after that because people are like going, oh, maybe they're drunk, maybe they're crazy or whatever. Peter's like, I'm going to take advantage of all these people being right here. Because God's power was just shown in an amazing way. Peter stands up, gives an incredible message, and then, what, a couple people are saved after that? Like 3,000 people then. You see, and he takes advantage of God's power being displayed in this act at Pentecost. Some also connect this gift that happened at Pentecost, shown at Pentecost, I should say, also connect this gift with the Tower of Babel and the ability to speak in different languages. If you remember early on in Genesis, the people were like, you know what, we're going to do our own thing. We're going to build our way to God. And God says, I need to divide these people. And what did God do to divide these people? He changed their language. Like, you know what? He didn't like send an angel and be like, hey guys, stop it, go away. He didn't do any of that. All he did was, and then they spoke a different language. And suddenly they're not united anymore. And then what do we see happen at Pentecost? We see them being able to speak in languages that people are able to hear. We see unity happening around God for the purpose of glorifying God. At Babel, we see people saying, using their own language, using the unity that they had, not to glorify God, but to glorify who? Themselves. And that's exactly what we see there. Language divides people or unites people. When God wants to divide people, he can use language. When God wants to unite people for his glory, he can use language. I'm going to give a few pieces of conclusion. If you have space to write three things down, kind of a takeaway from this. I know it's kind of just like a lot of information on what does Scripture have to say about tongues. I would encourage you, if you're in a place of like, this is just terrible, it's not ever supposed to happen today, like, look at what the Bible has to say. Read through Scripture. If you're like, yes, this has totally happened today and people just totally hate on speaking in tongues, read through the Bible. Just spend time, read through the Bible. And when I say that, I literally just like not picking up a commentary on this person's opinion or watching a video about this person's opinion or all of those, like, read, what does the Bible have to say on it? And where there's ambiguity, there's ambiguity. And where there's clarity, there's clarity. There's a few things about clarity that, there's a few pieces of clarity that Scripture is very obvious about. The first thing, this is not one of the three things, but order matters to God. Some people may think that order in the church service means that God can't move or there isn't room for the Spirit to do what he wants to do. But clearly we see from this look at Scripture that this is not the case. The end of this chapter is clear that clarity, not chaos and confusion, should be demonstrated in the worship service. Clarity should be demonstrated, not chaos and confusion. Three things to take away before we close. God cares about what happens in the local church. God cares about what happens in the local church, and so should we. So should we. I'll plug again the Book of the Quarter, A Place to Belong. God loves what happens, cares about what happens in the local church and how people care about each other, how people interact with each other, cares about there not being distractions as well. The second thing you could write down is this. God cares about how newcomers perceive the worship of God's people. One might say, this is just the way I worship, and it's all that matters. I like it this way, or I like it this way, and they just need to get over it. What we see here, and from what Paul had to say, was if an unbeliever, a new person, walks into church, what are they going to say? So clearly we know that God cares about how newcomers perceive the worship of God's people. And thirdly, God cares about his people being built up and designed the church to be a place that that should happen. God cares about his people being built up and designed the church to be a place where that should happen. And that, I think, valuable to anyone who's kind of on the fence about church, or like there's no real purpose. I can do my relationship with God all by myself. I don't need everybody else. We see from Scripture is like, no, the church is supposed to be a place where people are built up, where people are encouraged. And as ministry leaders, we should be thinking, am I building other people up? Are people being built up in what I'm doing in the life of the church? I'm going to stop there. A lot of different things, a lot of different opinions. I hope that that's helpful to you as we look through God's word. Next week, we'll look at the other portions of chapter 14. And see what God has to say about prophecy in the church. But if you're in a place of like, I'm not really sure how that even applies to me, I want to say this. The thing we should be pursuing in the church is love. That is foundational. That is what grounds us. That's the thing is Paul opens up in this whole passage before he gets into any of this discussion on stuff that can cause division in the church. He says, pursue love, chase after that. And so even as you have conversations with other people about it, or you look and see how is this displayed in the life of the church, should we do this or should we do that, first ask the question, am I loving other people well and practically? Am I being kind to them? Am I being patient with them? Like Paul clarified those things because that's what we should pursue first and foremost. Lord, we come before you today wanting to love you well, wanting to honor the people around us that you have put in our life. We can't do this by ourselves. We can't do this thing called walking with you, being a Christian. We can't do this of our own strength. So I just ask that you would give us a mind to set aside time to be with you, to let your spirit speak to us personally, individually, in our own day through the week, that we would trust that you will empower us, that you will give us the ability to love other people well, to edify other people. We want you to be glorified in the life of the church. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to close with a song. If you would like to maybe pray about something that's on your mind that's heavily sitting there, maybe you've been praying about it, but you'd like to pray with somebody else, Pastor Lester, I would love to do that. Maybe you're at a place where you're like, man, this whole tongues thing is super confusing and I don't really get any of the stuff that he just talked about. Get this, Jesus loves you deeply and wants to have a personal relationship with you. And the Spirit of God wants to abide in you, is jealous, is desiring of taking over you so that he can be glorified above all things. And that really is the best thing for every single one of us. No matter where division may be, different people's interpretations, glorifying God, loving other people, the best place that we can be as followers of Jesus, as humanity in this world. So let's stand and sing together.
You are God in heaven, and here am I on earth. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with you. And I'll stand in awe of you, Jesus. And I'll stand all, let our words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with you. Simplest of all love songs, I want to pray to you. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with you.
Love for us. Incredible love for us. We thank you. We praise you for that. Help us to lean into that this week. Your love for us. And because of that, we can love other people. We just praise you. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your grace and your mercy for us each day as we need it each and every day. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good week.